Good afternoon, more precisely, and welcome to this webinar. So I am very pleased to join this assembly and attendees. And so I was asked to speak about breast cancer and hormonal treatment, and mostly also how to assess the risk of breast cancer. So I will present a clinical case. Charlotte, she is 51 years old. She is consulting for severe climacteric symptoms, and she experienced menstrual irregularities since 2 years and was treated with progesterone for the last months, which is what we are doing currently in France to confirm the diagnosis of menopause and also alleviate hot flushes and VMS vasomotor symptoms before in the perimenopausal period. We give 10 days per month of progesterone, and when women don't bleed anymore, we consider that they are postmenopausal. So despite this treatment, her last menstrual period occurred 3 months ago. Her age at menarche was 14 years. She had a pregnancy at 28 years. Her BMI is 24. And in her family story, she had 2 sisters. One had breast cancer at the age of 62, and no other case of breast cancer in the family. So she's coming to your consultation and with vasomotor symptoms. So what will you tell her? So the first thing is to give information to the patient about the relative risk of hormone treatment, not only on breast cancer, but also on all the benefits and risk adapted to the clinical situation of the patient, and thus you have to evaluate her personal risk of breast cancer. So to do that, so the first part is to give her some evidence about breast. I will only address the question of breast cancer risk in this talk, because it's the subject of the day, but you have to inform her also on cardiovascular issues, evaluate her risk and osteoporosis and so on. So concerning the risk of breast cancer using menopause hormonal treatment, what is the evidence, the actual evidence? We know from many, many studies, including the Women Health Initiative randomized controlled trial, that combine estrogen and progestin carries a higher risk than estrogen alone. The hazard ratio of breast cancer in the WHI trial using conjugated estrogen and MPA was just significant, with a hazard ratio of 1.26 and the confidence interval beginning at 1.01, very quite low, up to 1.59. At the contrary, in the WHI hysterectomized randomized trial, conjugated estrogen alone without progestin was associated with a significant decrease risk in breast cancer. But from observational studies from the States, using mostly, where the women were using mostly conjugated estrogen, by example, the huge, big cohort of, from the nurses' health study. After 10 to 15 years old, duration of treatment with estrogen alone, there was a small increase in the risk. So maybe the result from the WHI was particular, we could discuss that further on. So from the literature, it's various data, epidemiologic data, observational study, case control study, it seems that the continuous treatment is associated with a higher risk than sequential treatment for breast cancer. There is a duration effect, the risk increase with duration, but decreased progressively after discontinuation of the treatment. thus suggesting very strongly, and this is the opinion of most of the experts of this field, that MHT is promoting pre-existing lesions, precancerous or in situ cancer, preclinical stage of cancer. Some studies showed that the lobular differentiation was more promoted by the treatment than the ductal one. The lobular one is especially hormone dependent. And also, we know for a long time that it was the breast cancer containing estradiol receptor which were mostly promoted, except in the WHI, and more recent studies confirmed that it was mostly the luminal A differentiation, which is breast cancer containing positive estradiol receptor, high amount of estradiol receptor and progesterone receptor, Ki-67 quite low and quite a good prognosis, but also few increase in luminal B, which are associated also with estradiol receptor, but usually not progesterone receptor, and the prognosis is less good than for the luminal A. So, can we select the patient in order not to increase the risk of breast cancer? We know from autopsy that like for other cancer, for breast cancer, 3 to 15% of women have small tumors when they die of less than 1 centimeter. So the hypothesis is that breast cancer is acting, promoting those lesions. So this chart, I like it very much because I think it's clear, meaningful, show that during the life of a woman, either carry a mutation with high risk of breast cancer that act very early in our life, and you know that most of breast cancer in carriers of BRCA1 and 2 mutations are premenopausal breast cancer, then during life carcinogen can act, and then transformation of cells leading to cancer can occur. Usually it's a long latency phenomenon. It takes 20 to 25 years from the first event to the diagnosis of breast cancer. And then the menopause hormonal treatment can act by promoting occult cancer pre-cancer lesion. It's what we call the promoter effect. It does not cut it. This is the chart from the conjugated estrogen only WHI trial showing compared to placebo in blue, in blue on the left chart, compared to placebo, there was a decrease, significant decrease in the rate of breast cancer here in women who had used conjugated estrogen. So this is the whole cohort of the whole trial population, and those are the ones who have really used the conjugated estrogen. And as you can see on the bottom of that slide, you can see that there was less death by cancer and less death by other cause, 30 compared to 6 and 50 compared to 16 in the group who used conjugated estrogen. So decrease in breast cancer and decrease in mortality. So this is the one of the last publications from the WHI 11 years after the first publication in 2002, so in July. And showing that still in the conjugated estrogen and MPA combined trial here, there is a small increase in the risk of breast cancer, but in the whole results in women 50 to 59 years old, there is a decrease in mortality. And this is the same here in the conjugated only trial. And furthermore, as I showed on the previous slide, you can see here that there is a decrease in breast cancer in that group. So you probably know well that there are some publications from France and also from Finland not randomized trial, observational studies in population and from registers, showing that with progesterone, micronized progesterone and dihydrogesterone, the relative risk of breast cancer is much lower than with when using synthetic progestins, and up to 60 years of treatment in the cohort from Françoise Clavel-Chaplon, the IFREN cohort, the relative risk of breast cancer was 1, not increased. Same with dihydrogesterone. So that was with progesterone and dihydrogesterone. From the study from Litinen from Finland, it was the same observation up to 5 years with dihydrogesterone. They did not have sufficient number of patients over 5 years of use. So they did not see any increase after 5 years because they had the number of patients using dihydrogesterone and the number of breast cancer was very, very low. And a case control study from France too, with different population than from the first trial. Also the same observation, no increase in the risk with micronized progesterone or dihydrogesterone. Françoise Clavel has republished more recently some data. Here on the top of this table, you can see women who have used progesterone, dihydrogesterone up to 5 years, over 5 years, more than 5 years here. The mean duration here was about 8 years. Up to 9 years here. And here, the women who have used 5 years or less or more synthetic progestin, and this confirmed after a longer follow-up than the first publication that the risk, the relative risk with progesterone or dihydrogesterone was absolutely not significant up to 5 years, but became significant at 1.3 here, significant. After a mean of 8 to 9 years of use, and concerning the synthetic progestin, the risk was already increased at 5 years and was at a higher, significantly higher level than progesterone and dihydrogesterone, twofold after a mean of 8 years here. And what is interesting is when the woman stopped the treatment, then the relative risk disappear is no longer significant in the group using progesterone and dihydrogesterone, whether they have used for about of 8 years of treatment, and it takes a bit longer to go back to normal using synthetic progestin. So I think those papers confirm that progesterone and dihydrogesterone are associated with a lower risk of breast cancer. So can we select patients at a lower risk? So for that, you have to evaluate in front of a given woman in consultation level of risk in breast cancer. So the higher risk are associated, of course, with in carriers are occurring in carriers of BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutation, or a same kind of family history of breast cancer but without mutation. A woman who has experienced a biopsy with atypical hyperplasia, lobular carcinoma in situ, or furthermore, ductal carcinoma in breast. I will show you later related with atypical hyperplasia. Study from the Mayo Clinic. Thoracic radiotherapy at a young age is associated. It's also carrying a risk of mutation, high risk of mutation, equivalent to genetic mutations and genomic mutation. And also the breast density is important. As you can see here on the mammogram, the BI-RADS classification of breast density is going from A, very fatty, low dense breast, up to D, with increasing breast density in glandular component of the breast, and the D category is associated, are extremely dense breast, and there is an increased risk of breast cancer according to increasing in breast density. I will also show you a study on that, showing that. So the category of intermediate risk are associated with the classical reproductive factors, young age at menarche, late age at first to term pregnancy, nulliparity, sedentarity as well, intake of alcohol, category of BRAD, it's BRAD C, diabetes, obesity, and family history at older age is associated with a lower increase of the risk between 1 and 2-fold according to the factor. So, at the contrary, young age, below, in fact, 20 or below, the age of 20 years old, the first full-term pregnancy is acting by differentiating the breast tissue and protecting against an increase in the risk. And this concerns mostly the premenopausal breast cancer. Important multiparity, 5 or over. But there is a recent paper just published 6 months ago suggesting that maybe multiparity, if the first full-term pregnancy occurs after the age of 25, is not a protective factor, but can be a worsening in the risk more than nulliparity. So it's new data. I think that the studies which showed in the past that multiparity was protective was also associated mostly with the young age at the first full-term pregnancy. So this paper, gives new data, and of course it has to be confirmed, but it has gathered cohort from all over the world, and it's opening the discussion about the protective effect of multiparity. But still, it's classical to show that, and as well breastfeeding over 1 year, low breast density, low BMI, low bone density have been associated with less risk in breast cancer. Exercise, I will show you meta-analysis recently published on that. And weight loss at any age seems to be beneficial. So even if a woman start menopause with a high BMI, I think it's important to tell her, try to convince her to exercise more. Energy intake, mostly physical exercise is very, very important. So if a woman belongs to a family carrying a mutation, BRCA1 or 2 mutation, you know she's at very high risk. If she has experienced thoracic radiotherapy, you know that she's at high risk. But in the intermediate category, it's not so easy to evaluate the risk and the category in where the woman falls in risk for breast cancer. So if you are not fully confident, then you can use scores. So there are different scores. They are not perfect, and they just help, to my opinion, to put the range to evaluate the range of the risk of the woman. And some patients think they are very high risk and are not. And you will show the curve to her and discuss with her. I will show you some example from this observation case, clinical case. And then also the opposite, she thinks she had no increased risk, she's not at risk, and then you can show that she's probably at risk. So the first score which has been published is the Gale score. It includes some of clinical risk factor, age at menarche, at first full-term pregnancy, number of biopsy, atypical hyperplasia, number of first degree with breast cancer and the race. But the C statistic, which is the accuracy, is quite low, around 60%, 0.6. There are some genetic scores which are used by people working in oncogenetic units to calculate the probability of being a carrier of genetic genomic mutation that we don't use currently in clinical practice, but the Hibiscus opinion the most because it combined the probability of carrying a gene, genetic factor and clinical factor, and it include more, it includes more, much more factors, much more clinical data than the Gale. And recently they have added to those that clinical data, the breast density. I will show you some example, and the C statistic, which was a bit better than for the Gale, now is around 0.7. Still, it's not perfect because that means you are predictive at 70%, not at 100%. So it's not, this is explaining what is a C statistic. If you don't have any score, any risk factor, you have, let's say we have 1 out of 2 chance to get breast cancer or like any disease. And the most the curve of the model is going close to 1. The most the model is have a high C statistic, a high accuracy. So here we are about between 0.6 and 0.7%, which is not which is better than 0.5, but it's not so. Those scores have some limitation because it expresses a statistical value within a population, and it has not been validated in all population. Most of scores do not integrate paternal case of third degrees. Overestimating the risk is not fully precise. But again, I think that it can help to discuss the level of risk with the patient, situate the magnitude of the risk, and also, if you are not very confident how to manage that, the indication of oncogenetic screening if there is a high probability of carrying a mutation. So this is, I don't know if you use that, the Eisinger score. It's a French epidemiologist and oncologist working in Marseille, and it's an old score now, but our recommendations are based on that. So if the score, so according to the family history, there is a breast cancer in the family, in a woman below the age of 40, the index is 4. And then according to the age, increasing in age, this level of score is decreasing. And if there is a breast cancer in a male, in the family, in a man, the score then goes up to 4. An ovarian cancer in the family at 3. And now the recommendation from our agencies is to send the patient to the oncogenetic consultation if the score is reaching 3 or over 3. So in this observation of Charlotte, she had only one sister with a breast cancer at 62, so her score is 1. So there is absolutely no need to send her to the oncogenetic unit. So this is the example of IBIS. So I put some data from the data from Charlotte we knew. The only thing is that in that observation, it was missing. I have no time to show you because we are limited in time. So her mammogram. So I put her, as you can see here, the age of menarche, her age and weight. She's parous. She had her first child at 28. She had no experience any biopsy. She's just postmenopausal at the age of 51. She's not using MHC for the moment. And she has a B BI-RADS category of breast density. You can choose here the reference of the breast density according to your the radiologist who performed the mammogram. She has two sisters, one experienced breast cancer at 62, another one that is now what has 65 years old, and a parental grandma, maternal grandma died without any breast cancer. And so you can put here all the family. You can see it's very detailed. And the most of the clinical factor here, it gives you the genetic tree, which is also interesting. And then you can calculate the risk, and the results is given as a 10 years risk at 10 years for the woman, the patient compared to the population, the average risk, and the lifetime risk of this patient. So as you can see, the past history of her sister, postmenopausal, does not increase significantly her risk. So you can tell her, because a lot of physicians and a lot of patients believe that if there is one case of breast cancer from the mother or grandmother or even a sister in postmenopausal age, MHT is contraindicated. So it's not exactly the case. It depends on the number of cases in the family, the age when the breast cancer occurs, and also the number of relatives with breast cancer or without breast cancer. So the most you have a relative without breast cancer, if she would have 5 or 6 sisters, only one experiencing breast cancer, then the probability of carrying a genetic factor is, of course, extremely low. So the risk of breast cancer with a family history depends on the age of the breast cancer, pre or postmenopausal, the number of relatives with breast cancer, and the number of relatives in the family. And it's a probability of carrying a genetic factor, which decreases with increasing the number of relatives. And it's not a contraindication. So then I have put here, as an hypothesis, breast density category D, Bio-Rad category, extremely dense, and the same history concerning the other factor. As you can see here, it's increased drastically her risk of breast cancer. So it's multiplied almost by threefold compared to the average population. So, of course, it depends which number they have included in their model. It's Cusick and Tyra who run this IBIS score. And so the hypothesis has been included according to the literature of increasing risk with breast density and so on and so. So it depends on what you put in the model. So it's not, of course, measuring directly the risk of your patient, but still, it gives an indication of the level of risk according to the various factors. So now I have added the fact that she had a biopsy with hyperplasia without atypia, but a B category of Bio-Rad, and then you see here there is a twofold increase in breast cancer in this woman. So she's not a good candidate for MHT if she has. Well, the problem is the level of the risk. So as I told you, IBIS is overestimated the risk. For the American risk of 20% is considered as a high risk. In Europe, it's most up to 25%. But still, you have to take in consideration that IBIS is overestimating the risk. So in the previous slide, she was at 24%. So she's at increasing risk, but would say not so high, but at the limit of high risk. And here, if she has a biopsy with, again, hyperplasia, and she has extremely dense breast density, extremely high breast density, then you see here that she's evaluated as being at very high risk. So this tool help, again, it's not perfect, but if you are not so familiar with breast cancer risk, I think can help to see the category of the patient. So this is the paper I was speaking of earlier from the Mayo Clinic. So they have looked at the risk of invasive breast cancer in women who has experienced a biopsy with atypical hyperplasia. So they showed the delay and the risk of getting invasive breast cancer. And also they show for the first time that according to the number of foci, which has been diagnosed in the biopsy, recorded in the biopsies, of course the risk increase. If there is one focus, then after 25 years of following the biopsy, the risk of getting an invasive breast cancer is 24%. It's not 100%, 24%. If there was three foci or more, then it was doubled up almost 15% risk. So this is also important to take in consideration, I think. So this is the study about breast density, one of study on breast density from Carla Kerlikowski from California, and she has gathered more than 1,350,000 mammograms, and 14,000 breast cancer were diagnosed. And according to the four category of BI-RADS, so at that time it was 1 to 4, now it's A to D. So you can see that taking as a reference the category 2, having low breast density, fatty breast, is associated with a decreased risk in premenopausal women, postmenopausal without treatment, postmenopausal with treatment, without difference between estrogen alone and the combined treatment. And then the risk increased with increasing category of BI-RADS, increasing breast density in premenopausal women, postmenopausal without treatment, and postmenopausal with treatment. And in that study, she did not observe any difference between the estrogen only and the to believe that breast density is an indicator of risk, which has to be taken into consideration. Also, what we know is that in category BI-RADS 4, BI-RADS D, and BI-RADS C sometimes, the diagnostic of breast cancer is more difficult because the breasts are dense and it's difficult to see sometimes an abnormal focus, and it can be also delayed, the diagnosis can also be delayed. So this suggests from the promoter effect I addressed at the beginning of this talk, of promoter effect of MHT on pre-existing lesion, that women to be excluded, or at least at first line from MHT, are women with high risk. So let's say genetic background, thoracic irradiation, and biopsy with a precancerous lesion, and probably women with high breast density. But then we have to discuss with the patient according to the other risk factor and to quality of life. But I think that in those women would be wise to begin as first line with a non-hormonal treatment for climacteric symptoms. A recent study from the SWAN published in 2016 here, showed some completed the evidence about the association between VMS symptom, vasomotor symptom, and breast cancer risk. Up to that publication, there were two case control studies showing that women who experienced severe VMS had the less study from Mishra, which has a different methodology than the SWAN study, which has been performed in the US. So this Australian longitudinal study did not see any difference in breast cancer risk in women with VMS, but in their discussion, the author from Swan said that the record of VMS in that Australian study was only every 3 years, so that they could have missed the occurrence of VMS. And in the Swan study, which is a long longitudinal follow-up study of women during the menopausal transition and in postmenopause, they apparently they see decrease hazard ratio for breast cancer, just significant. And they look according to the ethnic, it was performed in the US where there are Caucasian, Asian, Afro-American and Hispanic women. And it was mostly significant in Caucasian women, not so much in the other ethnies. And this effect was also more significant among lean women with normal BMI than in overweight and obese women. And if they restrict their analysis to women who fully transitioned to menopause during their study, then the adjusted hazard ratio was extremely significant as well. So it would be, if it is true, would be extremely interesting because it's exactly the women who would benefit from MHT. So I think we still need some more evidence and the biological mechanism of that, because we can imagine that if women have a lot of VMS, then they are less sensitive to their endogenous estrogen and are producing less endogenous estrogen, and then the treatment could be associated with a lower risk. But we don't know exactly the mechanism, so I think that up to that, we still have to remain prudent on that, but it's an interesting paper bringing quite a new perspective for the MHT and breast cancer risk. So can we choose a treatment also? We can choose the women, select the women according to the risk, and maybe we can also propose to those women a treatment with at low risk. So I showed you already that progesterone and dihydrogesterone was associated with less risk, conjugated estrogen in the WHI, alone, of course, if in hysterectomized women. But again, some observational studies suggest that conjugated estrogen at long term was associated with a small risk. Combining a SERM, an anti-estrogen, you know that there is TSEC commercialized, Duaviv, conjugated estrogen combined with bazedoxifen. And there is a concept, French concept, which unfortunately has not been really developed so far, which was from my mentor, Professor Mauvais-Jaravis, suggesting to apply on the breast for hydroxytamoxifen percutaneously and combined with treatment transdermal estradiol. And some data has been already gathered in the 20 years, and for hydroxytamoxifen is absorbed from the topical administration on the breast and could concentrate with a very, very low systemic diffusion to the estradiol receptor in the breast. So I think this concept is very, very smart, but it's not, nobody is interested in developing that. So we have a small study who has looked at combination of 5 mg of tamoxifen, very low dose. You know that in breast cancer treatment, it's 20 to 30 milligram, which is administrated, and compared to placebo, randomized trial. And this hot study, I don't remember if I have put the slide. No, sorry. And just for sake of time. And they showed that in women who use 5 mg of tamoxifen with estradiol treatment, there was a decrease in luminal A breast cancer, which sounds logical because it's the most hormone-dependent and ER-positive breast cancer containing the highest level of levels of estradiol receptor. So the concept is wise. Then the problem of systemic of administration of tamoxifen, as you know, is increasing risk of VTE, of venous thrombosis, and endometrial cancer. So I think that the topical administration on the breast is much more seductive. So also, one can ask if it's better to use conjugated estrogen than estradiol, because in the WHI there was a decrease in breast cancer in women using conjugated estrogen, maybe because they were extremely obese, and one of the benefits of the treatment is to decrease insulin resistance and prevalence of diabetes too. But in the part of the observational study from the Women Health Initiative, it's not the part of the randomized, it's that also observational study, they did not see any benefit, any difference in terms of breast cancer between conjugated estrogen and transdermal. So her hazard ratio for breast cancer was not significant, and they did not see any difference according to the dose of conjugated estrogen also in that observational study. So far, no full evidence that we have to preferentially use one type or another type of estrogen. Oh, sorry. So this is a hot study, but because I will go on because I have no much time left. In women with moderate to high risk, can we decrease the risk? We know that, again, combined MHT is at higher risk than estrogen alone, but I would not advise to use combined MHT in women, to use estrogen alone in women with an uterus. We know that women with oophorectomy and maybe hysterectomy, the risk of breast cancer could be lower, so maybe those are good candidates. Concerning premature menopause and inhaler, the scope is totally different. We consider that the benefits at the quality of life endpoints and cardiovascular disease and mortality are much higher than the risk in breast cancer. So they are not concerned, even if they are at higher risk of breast cancer. All what I told you so far does not apply to women with premature ovarian failure. So that I have already addressed. So there was a publication from the WHI and one publication from Françoise Clavel suggesting that if women were treated far from menopause, then there was a lower risk of breast cancer. This has not been confirmed in the further publication, later publication of the WHI. And we know that the mortality is decreased, and most of the risks are decreased in women who are treated by MHT between 50 and 60 or in the 10 years following the menopause. So I don't think we have to take consideration, but in women cells after the menopause, the treatment, maybe her risk in breast cancer could be lower. Not fully confirmed, but to be discussed. Women with high BMI have no additional risk with MHT, and as you already discussed, lower breast density is not associated with increased risk. And there was a publication from WHI suggesting that women who experience mastalgia at the start of treatment or during the treatment have higher risk. So this is also a very French idea. We found some of my collaborators have published studies on that, showing that women who experience long-term mastalgia during their reproductive life are at higher risk of breast cancer. This is not fully admitted by all the scientific community, but we take into account these symptoms during MHT, considering that could be a reflection of intolerance of estrogen by the breast. So decreasing, then if it occurs, you have to decrease the dose of estrogen, maybe to increase the dose of progestin or move to another kind of treatment. So higher BMI don't have the same increase in the risk current user, past users, compared to no treatment and current user, no significant increase in the risk in obese women and significant increase in lean women or overweight women. So it has been shown in several studies so far. So it seems that the exogenous estrogen does not add to the endogenous estrogen, maybe the additive risk. So this is a study from Mastalgia, and it's showing that breast tenderness, mastalgia, the combined treatment was associated with an increased risk in breast cancer, whether it was existing at baseline or during MHT. And it was not apparent with estrogen alone treatment, in the estrogen treatment. So another way to decrease the risk is maybe to teach, to educate the patient by decreasing their risk by modifying their lifestyle. We know that alcohol increases the risk, inactivity, sedentarity increase the risk, and exercise decrease the risk. And as I told you previously, weight loss at any age is associated with less risk in breast cancer. So, cannot see that slide. Don't know what was the, it was the, no, the last, okay. So the previous slides show this meta-analysis from, I think, 12 studies on physical activity and the risk of cancer. And they showed in the previous slide, I don't know why it's not, anyway. So a decrease in all the cancer except the melanoma and prostate cancer, which was melanoma probably because of solar exposition and outside jogging or sport outside is increased. But all the other cancer, and especially the digestive cancer, esophageal cancer, liver cancer, colon cancer, is decreased with physical activity. And in that slide, they have looked at the part of the population who used MHT or never used, and the benefit of physical activity remains on breast cancer. It's here. Voilà. So it's not because you use MHT that physical activity is not decreasing the risk of breast cancer. So still remaining for breast cancer. So you can educate the patient. So I don't know, but the slides are not going on. Can you help me? Okay. We don't see the slides. So, no, okay. But some slides are not visible. Cannot see them. Okay. It was slides showing, I know the slides, they were showing in different cohort the effect of applying good lifestyle compared to bad lifestyle, and they show the protective, it's a modelization, but in different cohort in USA and the EPIC study also, European from 10 European cohorts, showing that acting on BMI, alcohol intake, sedentarity, and I think smoking as well. There was a decrease in breast cancer. So according to one study to another, the decrease is more or less important, but it's still always significant. So I think that if you decide to give MHT, to prescribe MHT to a patient with increased risk in breast cancer, then you can convince her that having a better lifestyle factors could help her to decrease her risk in breast cancer. Here it's the attributable part of breast cancer, breast cancer, endometrial, ovarian, and colon cancer, according to alcohol intake, obesity, physical activity, and MHT. And as you can see, concerning MHT, it's always a smaller part than the risk associated with sedentarity, obesity, alcohol. So you can also tell to the patient, and of course the obesity is extremely associated, very, very high risk for the endometrial cancer. And as you know, in the WHI and some of the observational study, there is colon cancer risk decreased with MHT. So I think you can show to the patient this kind of results. So this is in percent of breast cancer, part of breast. So I think when you manage a patient, a given patient with risk in breast cancer, then you have to take into account all the benefits and the risk of the treatment. And if she is very, very symptomatic, it's different from the fact that she has only a few VMS symptoms, osteoporosis, diabetes type 2, the WHI randomized trial, the HERSE, heart estrogen replacement study, which was randomized in women with already who had already experienced in myocardial infection or unstable coronary disease, showed also those two trials, randomized trials, showed the decrease in prevalence of diabetes type 2, and it's of course a very, very important risk for cardiovascular disease. And in the French cohort from Françoise Clavel, again, with estradiol and micronized progesterone, it was the group which had the lowest prevalence of diabetes type 2. As you know, micronized progesterone is not associated to any modification in insulin resistance. The cognitive disorders, evidence is not robust to say that MHT is decreasing Alzheimer, but there is some studies suggesting that taking early in life, like for the cardiovascular disease, what we call the window opportunity or timing hypothesis, taking MHT early after menopause could decrease the rate of Alzheimer could postpone the appearance of Alzheimer. But still, it's not in the WHI. There were more dementia, but women had a mean age of 63 years and they were not close to menopause. Colon cancer, so it was shown decrease in colon cancer. So with a past history, family history of colon cancer, is that a good indication? There is no data on that, but could be a part of the discussion. So how to choose MHT, transdermal estradiol for the coagulation issue and arterial risk and micronized progesterone seems to be the best option. Tibolone, the place of tibolone could be in women who do not tolerate, the combined treatment because of mastalgia, but it has not to be used in women over the age of 60 because of increased risk of stroke. Progesterone alone, we do that quite a lot in France in women who cannot tolerate estradiol because they have mastalgia, or because they are bleeding with an adenomyosis, or because they are contraindication to estradiol. And progesterone is quite efficient, not as much as the combined treatment, but quite efficient to decrease, alleviate vasomotor symptoms and sleep disorders. But of course, in women with high risk in breast cancer, we don't have any data on progesterone alone in those patients. So how long to treat? I think the risk of breast cancer increases with duration, but what I am telling to the patient is as long as you need it, and with progressive decrease in the dose of estrogen and progesterone. Who will benefit on annual screening? Maybe women with high breast density and women with high risk. And of course, a one-year clinical examination is very interesting. The prescription of MRI is limited to women with very high risk. and the family history of breast cancer. And in those women with high risk, then I think that the first line could be alternative. So tibolone, you know, what is tibolone? It's a progestin with some metabolite, androgen and estrogen metabolite. And in the osteoporotic study, there was no increase in the risk of breast cancer, but in the Liberate study in women with breast, or who have already experienced breast cancer, there was an increase in recurrence. So probably the risk in breast cancer is equivalent to the, to MHT. And because of risk in stroke in the LIFT study in women who were 67 years old, you have to be prudent to use it in women over the age of 60 or women with cardiovascular risk factor. So I spoke already about this association of TSEC. So it was shown that breast density at 24 months can go next slide. There was no increase in breast density, no increase in mastalgia. I cannot go on with the slides. Can you help me, please? So it was also on mastalgia. I don't know why those slides cannot be seen. So then I will finish by discussing the non-hormonal alternative, the SSRI, SNRI, gabapentin, citalopram, clonidine, not very, very efficient, and also the alternative medicine. There are some randomized studies, not double-blind, but randomized studies showing that yoga, acupuncture, meditation, mindfulness could help. And of course, it has to be promoted in women if they agree to, without any risk, specific risk. So here is, I don't know if you can see, the percent of hot flushes and the severity of hot flushes. And these are the, compared to placebo, all the drugs which has been used in randomized trial and showing a kind of efficiency on VMS and severity of symptoms. So paroxetine, venlafaxine, desvenlafaxine, citalopram, escitalopram, gabapentin and pregabalin. So they are all efficient, but as you see, not as much as the treatment, because it's around 50-60% of efficacy. You have to tell to the patient, patient with breast cancer, mostly who would benefit of this kind of therapy, that it takes at least 2 to 3 months to be efficient. And you have also to begin at low dose and increase progressively the dose. On that chart, you can see the dose. And it's a publication we have done on recommendation from the Endocrine Society on MHT. You can find this figure. So here it's a study on sleep showing here that mindfulness was the most efficient in terms of benefit on sleep. So if I can have the last slide, it's a take-home message. So I think it's important. You cannot do something to make the slides visible. No, this one, yes. Okay, so I was saying that the risk in breast cancer increases with duration. It's a mild risk. It's a promoter effect. Maybe by selecting the patient and educating women with lifestyle, choosing the best treatment would help to decrease the risk. And that always it has to be weighed against the benefits of the treatment, of course. And in breast cancer survivors, no time to address that question. For us, it's a contraindication of for MHT. And again, you should have to assess the individual breast cancer as cardiovascular risk, as osteoporosis, and so without before prescribing MHT. And do not forget all that lifestyle and education. So thank you very much for your attention. And I will finish by promoting the very, very soon Congress of IMAS, which will be set, held in Berlin in a few days. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor, for your wonderful presentation. And I see that we have some questions. So the first question, is there a definite difference in risk using micronized progesterone versus a progestin?
Yes. I show that. What is exactly the question?
Yeah, it's a question asked by Martin Gelly. So if you could specify the questions, we will answer, and then we can move on to the another question, which is asked by Maria Navas. And okay. What about with DHEA in patients with breast cancer?
Okay. So what is the question about progestin and synthetic progestin? The base of this difference is the mode of action and the selectivity, the absence of selectivity of progestin. You know that progesterone is antiandrogen, has no real glucocorticoid effect. MPA, we have published that years ago, and some other also showing that MPA is a glucocorticoid androgen, and the normal breast is absolutely full of glucocorticoid receptor. The trial from Karolinska with biopsy in breast from normal postmenopausal women. One of the group used estradiol and MPA. The other group used transdermal estradiol and micronized progesterone. And they published on proliferation and apoptosis and gene regulation. And they showed that with the combination estradiol, transdermal, and micronized progesterone, there was no increase in proliferation, which was not the case with MPA. It confirmed all the data we had before, and I have published that and wrote that in the paper, the review I published on progesterone, progestin, and the breast in the past. So there are many data confirming the epidemiology. I mean, biological data, preclinical data confirming the epidemiology. So concerning DHA, it's a very difficult question. DHA is a precursor. It can be converted to estradiol. It can be converted to testosterone because it's a precursor. It's a prodrug. So according to the metabolism of the woman, she will have probably more estrogen or more androgen. The question of androgen and the breast is complicated. It's very complex. So probably some of breast cancer are inhibited by androgen and some other are promoted by androgen. There are some data in the literature showing that using aromatase inhibitor, which increase the concentration of androgen, the circulating levels of androgen, are associated in a subset of patients with more recurrence of breast cancer. We know in the triple negative breast cancer, which are not concerned, which are not increased by MHT, that there is a subgroup of this breast cancer, which have androgen hallmark of pathway. So we don't know what we are doing with androgen. So probably in most of the case, it's not increasing the risk, but still it can be converted. They can be converted to estrogen. And in some subset of breast cancer could be promoting the growth of breast cancer. So it's very, very difficult to use. We don't know how to use androgen in France, at least.
Yes, so thank you very much for answering these questions. And I think we don't have any more questions. So thank you so much, and this concludes the presentation and webinar. Thank you so much for your wonderful presentation, Professor, and all attendees for being here today. Thank you, everyone, and have a great rest of the day.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.